Friends and students here at SUU, welcome to Teaching and Learning at Southern Utah University, the podcast that delves into the dynamic world of education in one of the most vibrant academic communities. Join us as we explore innovative teaching methodologies, insightful discussions with educators, and inspiring stories of student growth. Whether you're a seasoned educator or a curious student or simply passionate about the art of learning, this podcast is your window into the enriching experiences that shape Southern Utah University's learning environment. Tony Pellegrini here with Southern Utah University's Teaching and Learning podcast. And we've got as a guest today, John Lisonbee, our staff association president. John, could you give us a little background about yourself? Tell us a little about your time and tenure here at SUU and maybe even a little beyond as well.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. Tony, thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to join you guys with this fun podcast. Myself, John Lisonbee, I am a father of four and been married for, next week we'll be going on 21 years. We got married on Valentine's Day. Which we always celebrate the day after, means flowers are cheaper. Fun fact. going on 21 years with my wife, Natalie, and we've got five kids, one of which now is our first full-time student here at SUU. So that's fun. So life is busy outside of work and what we do here at SUU.
But I bet it's busy here at SUU for you as well, too.
It is busy here at SUU as well. But in my role here at SUU, my technical job is a programmer analyst. I work in the office of data analytics, which is I report up to Parker Grimes, and we are underneath the academic affairs line, so we report up to the provost. But we are still very much in connection with IT and are in the fifth floor of the ELC, and yeah, we're a part of IT still functionally and mentally. Here in my role at SUU, I do a lot of banner security, Argos access requests, and getting access to banner data, as well as many other hats. We don't need to get into all of those, but it's a fun role. I really enjoy my role here in this job. But beyond my tenure here at SUU, which I think I'm in my ninth year now, I graduated from SUU with a information systems degree, and then went to work for the Love Group for 5 years, and then came back here. So, and then since being back here, I was able to finish up my master's in cybersecurity and information assurance master's degree, which I was one of the first three candidates in that program, which was a really great experience for me. It was very valued. So. This is really great.
Exciting, exciting. Thank you. And we're so appreciative that you were willing to come here as our guest today as the president of a staff association. And that's kind of where I wanted to start with my questions this morning. When I first started here 100 years ago, 1987, was a director of student activities. And there was there was real balance between faculty and staff, even down to the number of positions. You know, they'd kind of wrestle back and forth between faculty and staff to make sure that there was kind of equalized. Can you share the primary goals or initiatives that you're looking or focusing on as the president of the staff association? Staff is so essential to our success and our student success here.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a great question. I really appreciate that one because very early on, and I think even as a student, I saw that this was a part of our culture, that there was a divide between faculty and staff, and it, I don't know that it was articulated, but it was felt. Coming back here to SUU from the Levitt Group, even amongst IT in some regard, much less, but I saw that there were some divisions and how that played out as far as culture and effectiveness and integration and all of that stuff. It felt like it could improve, but As things shifted within IT, I also recognized very clearly that there was that divide still with faculty and staff. And I became curious about that because I think one of the things that I really love about being here at SUU, particularly where I'm at in my role, is that we have a really, really great culture. There's a very innovative culture, an open, transparent, supportive culture. And that, for me, coming from where I was previously, was very refreshing. And there was ample opportunity for me to be able to reach out to other people and find out if I can work with them on this or work with them on that, whether it was IT or other departments or whatever it may be. And that just seemed to me the right way. And as I progressed further into my career at SUU, and I became more curious and started asking more questions and starting to get to know some of my faculty colleagues and getting curious, I just said, well, help me understand the faculty mindset. And so I would sit down with, you know, Dean Hayborn now at the time, or it was, you know, Professor Hayborn at the time, but now Dean. He was really gracious to be able to sit down with me and just help me understand it, help me understand their road and their day-to-day. And anyway, long story short, it really sparked in me, and at the same time, too, also having other opportunities to have some mentoring and professional development, particularly with President's Leadership Academy, which was an amazing academy for us to go through, helped enable me to be able to see that there's potential to make change in these areas. So if you fast forward to through that experience to now, that really helped lead me down this road of opportunity to make a change outside of my functional role, but to help contribute to the culture and to work on building things. And yeah, I don't know if you want to interject there, but
but you're doing great. You're really connecting. It really kind of leads me to I love your focus on that community, that collaboration among staff, but how that even broaches over into faculty. And so maybe you could give me some examples of how you foster that sense of community and collaboration among staff, but even, and you've done very well, you know, explaining with Bill and how you make those connections with faculty as well, and how you continue those. Bill's got a great perspective on things here at SUU and beyond, but how you involve other faculty and staff in the process. Does that help?
It does help. Yeah, sorry. I just didn't want to be too much on a soapbox because I can keep going.
This is your soapbox. Today.
Well, okay. So with the mentoring and professional development I have received and saw the avenues for change and opportunity to help make an impact, I put myself out there in a way that, I could get nominated to be staff association president. Of course, I spent some time working in there as the professional development chair under Ralph Savage, and that helped me just understand a lot of what staff association is about. And then realized that the staff association at the time under our president, Tricia Robertson, realized that there was a really great opportunity to connect with administration and faculty to align efforts better. And for me, I saw that as an opportunity that might be where I could come and make the most impact. And I really hope that it is making an impact. But my whole goal was, it wasn't necessarily to place myself in that position. I think it came about organically. Mm-hmm. But I found myself being nominated by the right people to accept the position as the staff association president-elect. And in that mentoring and getting ready with Jason Matt Locke coming into this year, where I'm the president, my whole MO has really been to just build bridges and to continue the good work that the staff association's been doing over the last several years in elevating our effort, building those bridges and having more connections. So this year, really, I didn't start off with this campaign slogan per se, but I've used it a lot in saying, you know, my whole goal this year is to continue to just build bridges, to continue to build and foster that bridge with administration so that they have a better connection with our staff and knowing what is important to staff so that they know how to properly administer their roles because they do deeply care. And they ask this question over and over to our faculty, staff, and student organizations. What's important to you? We want to know. And so taking that role seriously. But beyond that, getting back to what you mentioned in regards to faculty and staff, I've had the opportunity, and I think there's a skill set I think I have and soft skills of just touching or connecting with other individuals and building relationships that can be effective. Kelly Goonan's the faculty senate president right now. She's doing an amazing job with the work that she's doing with faculty and being a voice and approaching things diplomatically, because there's a lot that goes on in these conversations. And she's been a great partner in advocating for each other and supporting each other in our roles, as well as Carson Brown in our SUSE president. But yeah, it's just been building bridges and having these connections and conversations and trying to tear down some of those walls, I think.
Let me follow up or just dig a little bit deeper. It wasn't a question I planned for here, but love your that motif or that metaphor of building bridges. What are some of the things, some of the approaches that you're taking now to ensure that that continues beyond your tenure? It's a wonderful, we've seen the growth. How can we continue that over the next year, 2, 3, 5, 10 years maybe even?
Absolutely. So one thing that kind of fell on Staff Association's plate recently in the last, let's see, year, Jared Tippett in his office was in charge of the superstar stations. That has been something that their team realized that maybe this would be best placed within our staff association because with what they had going on, there was the potential of burnout with some of those that were in charge of that. And we met and we decided, let's team up and then we'll take this on. And so we have. And in that effort, we've been able to open that up. And that's presented opportunity for faculty and staff to come together. And what that is, for anybody that's listening and haven't heard for the first time, it's an opportunity for those first couple of days of the semester in the spring and in the fall for our faculty and staff to sign up and volunteer for all these several different stations around campus to just foster a connection and support our students with whatever they need. Often it's, where's the bristlecone hall? Or where can I go to get this? Or where's this classroom or that classroom? And it's a simple connection, but we had a lot of faculty and staff engage in that. And it's been able to, for me personally, I can speak to, I identified faculty members that I wanted to get to know or spend an hour with, because that's what our time slots were. And in that 1 hour, it was just, you know, as students were coming and going, it provided us opportunity to connect. We're both people. We're both here as employees. We do serve different purposes, but we can find common ground. And in those conversations, it's been productive to be able to help support them and what they need, whether that's access to a dashboard or data that they didn't even know existed outside of their faculty role, or I just didn't understand the faculty mindset or what's going on in their department or their college. And coming curious has been a beneficial mentality, and it's provided lots of opportunity to connect with faculty and build that bridge.
So that's one effort. That is one, and we sure appreciate those. Can I give you my personal thank you? This was first time going through this in the spring. And first of all, thank you for getting us inside out of the cold.
Matt McKenzie. Yeah, he was very. we walked Matt. Around, and he's like, "This is going to be cold. Let's move this indoors."
So I loved that part. It was wonderful to be, and the cookies didn't hurt either. That was a big help too. Good. But it was just wonderful to be able to make those connections, because we get running 90 miles an hour in as faculty or as staff as well in our own jobs, our own responsibilities, our own little universe.
Yeah.
And it was great to reach out and connect with others. Thank you so very much for sharing. Our time is kind of running forward, and I did want to ask you just at least a question on your IT department member perspective. Since I've been here this time teaching since 2002, I've taught the educational leadership and technology class every semester, and so I know I live that rapidly evolving field of technology. How do you and your team stay updated on the latest trends and innovations and scary things that may be happening with technology as well, too? What are some of the things that you do?
That's a great question. Me personally, I'm an avid podcast listener, and that varies, all kinds of different podcasts. Some are tech-related. And I think there's just the general nerdery about the avenues that we listen to things. Some things pertain to work, but it's also just an avenue to allow trends or news or highlights into our day. Beyond podcasts that are very targeted, there's other newsletters. So I guess, for example, Banner, that's a big part of our campus and our database. And the way that we upgrade and or know what's working with Banner or not working with Banner, there's several different nationwide groups, like listservs or spaces or Slack spaces, things like that, that it's a community. And it takes a community to keep each other informed. And so those are active communities where daily there are dozens and dozens of communications. And some days it's hard to sift through what's important and what's not important. But I think collectively with this mindset that we all have, keeping our eyes open and our ears to the ground, we pull out the things that are important for us, especially in our role and for our university, for our development that we're focused on and things that we might need to adjust. But those are two ways that I And it's a lot, but it's enough to keep us busy.
It absolutely is. And yeah. I'm grateful that you've been able to share a couple of those ideas with us. Just kind of to conclude, I sure would like to pick your brain or have you share for our faculty, for our staff as well too, but for our students, any words of wisdom for our listeners to be able to fit in and to be successful here at Southern Utah University. Any words of wisdom from you?
That's a great question.
And take a yes. moment to breathe. You do yes. not take a moment. You do not have to answer immediately. Do you
well,
take
let
a
me,
breath?
Let me get some thoughts articulated here because in the last couple of days, I've been in – okay, so I enrolled in a leadership lounge, which is a professional development opportunity with a cohort facilitated and mentored by a technology group, but it is mentored by CIOs around the country. And that includes University of Hawaii.
Any travel associated with that?
No travel, no travel. This is all Zoom, fortunately.
Okay.
But some really high-end peers and mentor opportunity. And in these conversations, we've been having a lot of mentoring conversation, obviously, and a lot of that articulates back to me, obviously. But I think beyond that, students or any other professionals in learning this idea of coaching or mentoring is, I think, on everybody's mind. Whether you're a young professional or a seasoned professional, I don't think it matters. I think, especially in higher ed.
In education, we say lifelong learners.
Yeah, that mm-hmm. as well. And so mm-hmm. I think it would be right on that mark, one, adhere to that mentality that we are lifelong learners and find your ways of learning. For students, I think in their experience, it's having those personal connections with your teachers, your faculty members, and those that are staff as well. We, in the years to come, will recognize the need for that relationship-rich education. And for a student to come onto our campus, I think faculty, I think get it. They're in the class. They're the front line. They're there with the students. But our staff are also going to need to understand the importance of having that relationship experience with the students. And whether that's bringing them in as a student worker and mentoring them.
And the practical applications associated with that, absolutely.
Yes, and how that translates post-graduation, where you want to go in your career and what that might look like being at the bottom of the totem pole. I really appreciated that about one of our president, Scott Wyatt. He shared that in one of his commencement speeches, was just that, you know, it's okay. You just left an amazing experience here at SUU, graduating, you're moving on. Now you're going to be at the bottom of the totem pole, most likely. And knowing how to navigate that up and finding that mentor group where you can be coached, as well as identifying your and this came from one of the CIOs in our leadership lounge, which was finding your hype squad, finding those people that you trust, your inner circle, you know, 5 to 6 people that you really trust, that you can run things by, that you can get feedback from, honest, genuine feedback on, because that helps you drive in a way that's intentional and hopefully beneficial for you. And so the whole idea of coaching and mentoring and connecting with somebody is probably as purposeful as getting your degree, because that helps you to navigate with that credential where you're going to move into your life. And that's all learning. It's a day-to-day task.
It is a wonderful soft skill, as you brought up
Absolutely.
Earlier, that you're going to be able to take and into the world of work and be able to have those mentors, those associates, those trusted advocates that you have. So powerful. And I see that. I see many opportunities for our learners, for our staff, for our faculty to be able to engage with those.
Can I add one more point to this?
Please.
Nah, we could go on for days on this one.
But they won't listen to us much longer.
Yeah, you guys probably aren't going to listen to us all day long. But I do want to add also that in my own mentoring and coaching that I'm receiving and or giving, or, and just it's a 360 cycle, really, that there's the idea that, you know, you need to be able to be at the top to lead. And that's absolutely not true. I think for anybody listening, if you're a student or if you're an employee, wherever you're at in your career, if you have these aspirations to lead, but you don't feel like you've been given a title to lead, that you don't need to do that. You don't need to have that. I'm a programmer analyst. I'm trying to lead from the middle. And as you talk to leaders, they will tell you over and over again, they don't have the time to look at everybody and be like, oh, that's a leader. Let me elevate them to somewhere they can actually lead. They just need those that have the ability and or the brave soul to be able to just raise their hand and say, I think I can help here and take a chance. But the idea of leading from the top, obviously, you know, President Benson, she leads from the top, but she also needs all of us to be able to lead in our own positions. And so leading from the middle is something I would say, you know, you in your own spot, step into that light, be a little brave, expose yourself a little bit, check with your hype squad, but you can lead out where you're at. You don't have to be the CIO, the president, to be able to make an impact. And yeah.
I'm learning from you. I think you've got a book right there, Lead from the Middle. I think would be a wonderful book for you to write. And a wonderful podcast. Start with that, okay? Lead from the Middle. John, thank you so much for sharing your time and your talents with me today. And with our listeners, we appreciate you and are grateful for the opportunity to learn from you and learn alongside you. You make it a great week, okay?
Will do.
Thanks, John. Appreciate you.